Good afternoon and welcome to this very special event. I'm Ali Langton.
And I'm Peter Overton, and this is the coronation of King Charles III. We'll be with you throughout this historic afternoon and evening as the world witnesses a true spectacle.
It is a celebration that is steeped in tradition and grandeur, and for many, it's a once-in-a-lifetime event, coming almost 70 years since Queen Elizabeth II was crowned.
So this will be an almighty show. It's just gone 8 o'clock in the morning in London, but there's been no sleeping for the crowds of royal watchers who took up their positions many hours ago. These are live shots coming from the centre of London now, and there's been rehearsals for weeks with the military, I think up to 6,000 military taking part from across the Commonwealth, but now this is the real thing. This is the day where they have to be perfect, they have to be in time, and they have to be in tune.
And we've seen with the crowds, people have been camping out for days now to get the best vantage point. This is an extraordinary moment, and I think at this point we should bring in our very own royal expert. He knows everything to do with anything royal. It's Dickie Arbiter. Very good morning to you, London time, Dickie. Wonderful to see the preparations. It's almost time.
Yep, it is almost time. Good morning to you, Ali, and to Peter. There's a lot of excitement in London. It is overcast, unfortunately, but the rain that was forecast hasn't come yet. Let's hope the Met Office have got it absolutely wrong, because there's a lot of excitement amongst the people. There have been those camping along the Mall and along Whitehall and Parliament Square since Monday to be guaranteed a good position. What we've been watching just now are the Royal Marines, the Band of the Royal Marines, the Royal Marines contingent leading the Royal Navy. Some will be streetliners, some will be in the actual procession back to Buckingham Palace, numbering around about 7,000. It'll be a shorter procession and smaller procession coming out of Buckingham.
Well, that's what it's seeing there.
Household cavalry, it's the Blues and Royals and the Lifeguards. And what we're seeing now are people arriving at Westminster Abbey. The doors were open well before 8 o'clock. And there'll be a fair amount of screening because there's a lot of security on the ground. Ali.
We couldn't ask for a better person to be in the hot seat, Dickie Arbiter. Let's just have a look at Dickie's history. A press spokesman for Queen Elizabeth II, 1988 until 2000. And then, of course, he became the media manager for Prince Charles and the Princess of Wales. As we see pictures now of Westminster Abbey and the chair, the stone, everything where the coronation will take place. I think we're all voyeurs, Dickie. What would it be like this morning at Buckingham Palace as the King and the Queen Consort prepare for this huge day, not only for themselves, but for the family, for England, and indeed for the world?
There would have been an air of calm in Buckingham Palace. You've got to remember that the King has been through these ceremonial occasions ever since he really left the Navy. And as far as his wife is concerned, the Queen, it'll be a bit daunting for her. But they're alongside each other and they give each other support and they're very good with each other. So be an air of calm. They've done their rehearsals. They've rehearsed in Buckingham Palace. They marked out, well, they didn't, but the staff did. They marked out the ballroom in the shape of Westminster Abbey, so they knew where they had to walk and how they had to walk and how fast or how slow. And they've had their rehearsal at Westminster Abbey. Westminster Abbey is very familiar to the King. He's been there so many times, so many grand state occasions, that now he's the centrepiece. Quite interesting. I remember him seeing him on one of the balconies in Westminster Abbey in 1953 at his mother's coronation. He was only 4 and a half, and who would have thought that little boy, age 4 and a half in 1953, 70 years on almost, would be the centre of attraction, the centrepiece of this grand ceremony today.
You can only imagine, can't you, the number of years that he has been, you know, waiting for this very, very moment. But, Dickie, there was a lovely moment on the Mall. It was this morning our time, but it was late yesterday in London when the King himself and William and Kate made a surprise appearance and spent quite a bit of time meeting and chatting with people.
It was a terrific moment. They got their timing absolutely right because about an hour beforehand, the heavens opened and it literally chucked it down. The rain was bouncing off the Mall. But when they came out, it was sunny. The King was on the south side of the Mall. Public loved him and he spent a lot of time talking to people. He's done a lot of this throughout the months since his mother died in September. Wherever he's gone in the UK, whether it's England, Scotland, Northern Ireland or Wales, crowds have turned out. He's done the walkabouts. He did the walkabout a couple of weeks ago in Germany. He hit the ground running after the ceremonial welcome at the Brandenburg Gate. He did a walkabout. He did a walkabout when arriving in Hamburg at the station. He did another one in the square at Hamburg. He is a people person. And I think he's having the time of his life on this one because he's now got the top job and he wants to bring people together. He wants the inclusivity and he wants them to recognise that he's the right man for the job. He's had 46 years preparing for this since leaving the Navy in 1976. So he's done a lot of work. He's had a lot of rehearsal. He's had a good mentor in his mother, good help from his father. Now the job is his.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, I think it looks like he's really enjoying himself. Dickie, we're going to come back to you. Obviously, you're with us throughout the entire evening. You'll be explaining everything that we're seeing. But thank you. No one knows the new king better than you. So we'll chat to you in just a moment. Thank you. Well, we know that there'll be around 2,200 guests attending the service. But for most people, the chance to catch a glimpse of the monarch will come during the king's procession, which is on its way to Westminster Abbey.
Rehearsals have been going on all week, leaving nothing to chance for the ceremonial trip.
The journey the world will be watching begins in the heart of London, where King Charles and Queen Camilla emerge from Buckingham Palace in the Diamond Jubilee stagecoach.
The King's procession will depart through the centre gate and head down the Mall in front of cheering crowds.
The procession passes through Admiralty Arch and south of King Charles I Island. Then it's down Whitehall.
Finally, the King's procession passes Parliament Square to arrive at Westminster Abbey. In all, a 2.1-kilometre route that will be repeated in reverse 2 hours later when the King and Queen return to Buckingham Palace.
And we're just over 2 hours away from the procession leaving the palace and heading to Westminster Abbey. Let's say hello now to Camilla Tominey. She's the Associate Editor of Britain's The Daily Telegraph, covering all matters royal. Seeing that walkabout this morning of the King, of William and Kate, it reminded me, Camilla, of when William and Harry went walkabout just before William's wedding, how they came out and said hello to the crowds. Of course, Harry is the big X factor, if you like, in this jigsaw today. He's the one that we're all wondering how it's going to play out for him. Hello from Sydney.
Hello, morning. Yes, aren't we all? Well, the prodigal son, we believe, has returned. He's landed. There's been reports that he was spotted on an American Airlines flight. Some of the fellow passengers flabbergasted to see the ginger prince amid them. But what we don't know, Peter and Ali, is what kind of role he's going to be playing today. There's been lots of talk about how this is going to be a whistle-stop visit. It is his son Archie's fourth birthday today, so he's keen to get back to his family in Montecito. Of course, everyone knows that the Duchess of Sussex isn't travelling over to London for that reason. Quite a few reports in the papers this morning suggesting that he's going to be given a seat on the third row back, so that's a little bit of a relegation, that he isn't going to be wearing uniform or robes. Again, the distinctions being made between working royals and non-working royals. We saw this at the Platinum Jubilee, we saw it at Queen Elizabeth II's funeral, this idea that if you're non-working, and that also includes the Duke of York, then you're not going to have a front row seat. You're not going to be taking part in any of the processions and certainly not making that appearance on the Buckingham Palace balcony. We don't even know yet whether Harry's actually going to be appearing in the official coronation photographs because his people are saying that he really is on a tight schedule and it's a case of flying in and out. But as is ever the case with these sorts of major royal occasions, there's the occasion itself, the coronation, which all eyes will be on. But of course, people like me will also be looking out for some of the body language between Harry and his nearest and dearest, not least after everything that's been said and done in Spare.
Well, I mean, this is where it's sad, right? That Harry's coming back to London. This is a momentous occasion for his father. And that, you know, the likelihood is he won't even speak to his brother, is what's going to happen. But because I was reading your article, Camilla, just before we came on air, you reckon he might end up sitting between Princess Eugenie's husband, Jack Brooksbank, and Princess Alexandra, who she's a cousin of the late Queen. I mean, that's not exactly sort of prime time seating, is it?
It's not. And I think the Sussexes were on the second row at the Queen's funeral, so this is a bit more of a relegation. Look, anyone that was suggesting he was going to be placed in the sort of Westminster Abbey equivalent of Siberia was wrong. He's not going to be stuck behind a pillar at the back. But at the same time, he's not a front row royal anymore, and that's difficult perhaps for him and the family to accept. I think you're right, Ali, in identifying where the tension will lie. We know that the King loves his son, wants to bring him back into the fold. Any parent out there knows, you know, it's very hard not to forgive children, even if they've deeply hurt and upset you. The tension remains between Harry and William. And as Harry said in his memoirs, The Explosive Spare, that was published in January, they didn't exchange a word at the Queen's funeral. So it's highly, highly unlikely they're going to do so today. I also think because Prince Harry is flying out and therefore missing some of that private family downtime, there isn't going to be that opportunity for peace talks. Perhaps it's not appropriate anyway. Obviously, people have got a lot of things to worry about with the pomp and ceremony of today. Perhaps there was a hope that the royals might wanted him to stay a little longer this weekend. Then you could move some rapprochement talks into Sunday, but that doesn't seem to be happening.
OK, a penny for Harry's thoughts. I think that's what we all want. But stick with us, Camilla. We're going to come back to you very shortly in London. Nines, you're a correspondent. One of our big team over there, Carrie-Anne Greenbank, is at Buckingham Palace for you. Carrie, hello to you when the service is over and the King and Queen are back at the palace. It'll certainly be all eyes on that famous balcony behind you and who is standing on it.
Hello, Peter. Well, that's right. All eyes will be on the balcony here at Buckingham Palace for what essentially will be a reenactment of what we saw when the young Queen Elizabeth waved to the crowds in 1953 after her coronation. At the time, Prince Charles was 4 years old. Now it is his moment. He will be waving from that balcony as the King alongside Queen Consort Camilla. Now, what we're seeing here at the moment is there's a lot of police officers and service personnel that have been filing in to line the strip here outside Buckingham Palace in preparation for the King's procession, which will be getting underway from here in just over 2 hours. So we will see the King and Queen in the Diamond Jubilee State Coach heading from Buckingham Palace. That's the state coach that was designed and built by an Australian in Australia, by the way. They'll be heading from Buckingham Palace all the way through to Westminster Abbey ahead of the service beginning, Peter.
And, Carrie, I mean, being there in that spot, and that's where the King's procession will lead from, you've been in amongst the crowd. What are people telling you?
Well, it's a really exciting moment for a lot of people here. The crowds are packing to the mouth. And it's really interesting because the last time I was here outside Buckingham Palace was for the Queen's funeral. And the mood then, obviously, completely different to what we're experiencing now. Back then, not that long ago, September last year, it was obviously a very somber mood. But standing in the crowd then, I remember people in a hushed silence as the Queen's coffin passed by. I saw people wiping away tears, offering up a prayer for the Queen. Obviously, the emotion here today and the excitement is completely different. What we're seeing in the crowd is that there are people who have been lining up in preparation, staying overnight for days on end. There was plenty of excitement yesterday also when the King, William and Kate, did that walkabout saying hello to people. I saw a few people wiping away tears and hugging each other then as well. So, look, in terms of the mood here in London, it took a little while to kick off. I remember at the Platinum Jubilee, the mood was incredibly excited and enthusiastic for weeks ahead of the Platinum Jubilee. Here, it took a little while to develop, but what we're seeing today is that the crowds are absolutely delighted to be here for what really is a momentous moment in history.
That it is, Carrie. We'll come back to you during our broadcast this evening. Nines, you're a correspondent. One of our team is Brett McLeod, along with Carrie, of course, and he has the best seat in the house for the arrival of the King and the Queen just outside Westminster Abbey. I know that spot well. Brett, people have just started arriving at the Abbey. Hello to you.
Hello there, and yes, and I've got the benefit on them too because I'm undercover when that rain hits. But yes, hundreds of people already streaming in here, all of course in their finest outfits, morning suits, their frocks, their hats, their fascinators. We have the great and the good here, but it's not just the lords and ladies. Many of the people coming in now are actually representatives of volunteer groups, those who had to do the most and sometimes suffered the worst during the height of the pandemic, which of course hit Britain extremely hard. So this is a way of summing them getting a thank you by having a seat at the coronation. And of course, there'll be quite a few Australians among that group as well, from household names such as Nick Cave and Adam Hills to others who are famous in the area of arts and science and that sort of thing. So there's still close to 3 hours before the service gets underway, but with more than 2,000 people having to be seated and a lot of security to go through, you can understand why it's taking a while to get everyone streaming in. And at about 11 o'clock local time, we will see the Golden State carriage pull up behind me, and that's where the King and Queen will exit. And on that, already, we have referred to Camilla as the Queen Consort, and that's the way it's been written in a lot of articles. She is actually the Queen right now, so after today, we will use that title more commonly. She will be Queen Camilla, along with King Charles III.
Well, when Camilla and Charles got married, Ali and Brett, in 2005, it was announced that Camilla would be intended, was the key word in this, intended to be known as Princess Camilla when Charles took the throne. But the intended was the key word, because of that has changed as affection has grown for her, and she's played such a critical role in shaping Charles in this era. So it is no surprise that she will be the Queen, and I think Her Majesty wanted that as well.
Well, I think Her Majesty made that very clear, didn't she, in her final months, that this was something that she supported and endorsed, and I think that's probably had a lot of sway with the English people, Brett. I mean, how are you finding the popularity of King Charles and Camilla, who will now be Queen?
The rehabilitation of Camilla in the public eyes here has been quite extraordinary. I mean, we remember what it was like when Charles and Diana's marriage broke down. She was the other woman. And from there, she spent a lot of time doing charity works, sort of keeping calm and carrying on, really, in order to just show she was a working royal. And that stood her in good stead. And as for Charles, I think his response after his mother died won a lot of people over. There was a lot of doubt about whether he could carry on and keeping the same sort of tradition and respect that she had. But from the very moment when he drove into Buckingham Palace as king, stopped the car, and he and Camilla got out and greeted crowds. This is in the 48 hours after the Queen had died. I think that had a great effect in winning people over. And since then, he's been out in public quite a lot. And again, very hands-on, literally hands-on, shaking hands, taking selfies, that sort of thing. So I think they're adopting what might be called a Scandinavian model when it comes to royalty, being a lot more approachable, being there in front of people, stopping and chatting, having conversations in ways that perhaps the Queen was a lot less able to do in her latter years because she was so infirm and seen less in public. So Charles has done a lot of work to rehabilitate his image as well, and the opinion polls show it's working.